So the first video had introduced this notion of sum of weighted execution times, and I had introduced those weights to make sure that every program received roughly an equal amount of importance. Okay, but you know, this had to be done through a reference machine, and we weren't happy about that. Okay, but now having discussed the performance equation, we have the tools to perhaps consider an alternative measure, which does not require a reference machine, but still allows me to be fair to every single program. Okay, so let's look at, you know, what that measure would be. So, you know, let's say that I have, let's say that I have an old laptop and I've bought a new laptop as well. And there's program A that I would like to benchmark on it. Okay, so what I do is I let program A run for one cycle on my old laptop and I measure the IPC, the instructions per cycle. And what I observe is program A takes, you know, roughly 1.2 instructions per cycle, which means, you know, if I give it one cycle to execute, it'll get through 1.2 instructions. Then I give it one cycle to execute on my new laptop as well, and maybe it's able to get through 1.4 instructions on average. And based on this, I can conclude that the new laptop is perhaps better. Okay, and this is assuming that both have the same clock speed. So I'm going to assume same clock speed for now. But if the new laptop has a higher clock speed as well, that's even better, right? So I should essentially be multiplying IPC with clock speed. But for now, let's assume same clock speed. So let's just go with IPCs. Okay, so you know, now I have this new measure. I'm essentially giving a program, you know, one cycle to execute on a machine. And the IPC is a measure of, you know, how well this machine is doing. How many instructions can I get through in that one cycle opportunity? Okay, so now if I have a large benchmark suite, you know, lots of different programs, how do I capture, you know, all of their IPCs? Let's look at the sum of IPCs and let's see if that represents something real and something meaningful. Okay, so for three programs, you know, the IPCs are 1.2, 1.8, and 0.5. Okay, so sum of IPCs is basically adding up 1.2 instructions for one cycle, right? 1.2 IPC is 1.2 instructions per cycle of execution. And then to that, I'm adding 1.8 instructions for one cycle, and then 0.5 instructions for one cycle. Okay, so essentially, the sum of IPCs is measuring the total number of instructions I can finish if I allow each program to run for exactly one cycle. So it is representing something real. It is telling me the throughput, assuming every program gets an equal weight in terms of number of cycles. Okay, so it's a pretty good measure. Okay, now let's look at alternative perspective two. Let's weight the program such that every program gets to run for an equal number of instructions. Okay, so in that case, if I were to flip that around, now the number of cycles that it takes me to finish one instruction is a measure of how well a program is doing on a given system. Okay, so now if I have a large benchmark suite and I want to measure it, let's see if sum of CPIs turns out to be a decent measure, right? So sum of CPIs is essentially adding up, you know, 0.8 cycles for every one instruction that you finish, plus 0.6 cycles for every one instruction that program B finishes, and, you know, 2.0 cycles for every instruction that program C finishes. So the CPI, sum of CPIs, is 3.4 cycles for every three instructions, where every program contributes one instruction. So this is also a reasonable measure. It is essentially measuring the execution time while weighting every program equally in terms of the number of instructions that they finish. Okay, so, you know, both of these measures are pretty good, right? They are being fair to every program because every program is either getting to execute the same number of instructions or the same number of cycles. And I was able to do this without using any kind of normalization, without using any kind of weighting. So that's why I like this metric. And it also represents something real. It is representing a real workload where each program is running for one instruction, or it's representing a workload where each program is running for one cycle. Okay, so, you know, this is a pretty convenient measure which does away with normalization. I should also point out that there is this relationship between AM of IPCs and HM of CPIs. Okay, so AM of IPCs is somewhat equivalent to the harmonic mean of CPIs. If you've forgotten what harmonic mean of n numbers is 1 by the arithmetic mean of the inverses of those n numbers. Okay, and that's how you kind of get this relationship between AM of IPCs and HM of CPRs. Okay, so if you have a benchmark suite where you'd like to run each program for an equal number of cycles, then AM of IPCs is a pretty good measure, which is, you know, similar to using the HM of CPIs. Instead, if you have a benchmark suite where you'd like to weight the program such that they all execute for an equal number of instructions, then the AM of CPIs would be a more appropriate measure. Okay, so, you know, what about the geometric mean now in this case, right? So, you know, I'll quickly mention that the GM of IPCs is nothing but the inverse of the GM of CPIs. And, you know, let's look at what the GM is trying to do. It's basically multiplying IPCs. It's multiplying instructions. So again, it does not represent anything real. It gives you a warm, fuzzy number, but it does not represent any real entity. Okay, but it does fix the one weakness of using AM of IPCs, right? I said that we are giving each program an equal level of importance because every program is running for an equal number of cycles. Okay, but if some program has a really high IPC, it's going to play a huge role in that final AM of IPC number, right? So, you know, in this previous example over here, you know, this program, or rather, let's go to the IPC numbers, right? So in this case, this program over here with a very small IPC is not playing a huge role in this final measure over here, right? So, you know, maybe this is a program that I should not optimize and I should focus my optimizations on this high IPC program. Okay, so, you know, it leads to these possibilities for gamesmanship. But otherwise, the AM of IPCs is a pretty good, it's a pretty good measure. Okay, so now, you know, before I finish, I just wanted to clarify the differences between the term speedup and percentages, because they're often used to compare different systems, right? So very often you'll hear someone saying that I bought a new laptop and it gave me a speedup of 10%. This is actually a wrong statement. What the person meant to say is that the new laptop gave me a performance improvement of 10%. Okay, so, and this is because speedup is actually a ratio. It is a ratio of old execution time by new execution time. Okay, so the old laptop, you know, took 100 seconds to execute a task. The new laptop took 90 seconds to execute the same task. That gives me a speedup of 1.11. So that is what the person should have said. I bought a laptop, it gave me a speedup of 1.11. Or alternatively, it gave me a performance improvement of 10%. Okay, and so when you say improvement, you usually mean, you know, new performance minus old performance divided by old performance. So let's go through these different terms with one concrete example. So a program took 100 seconds on the old laptop, 70 seconds on the new laptop. Speedup is 100 by 70 equals 1.42. Let's first look at the reduction in execution time. So it is new execution time, 70, minus old execution time, which is 100, divided by old execution time, which is 100. So this is minus 30%. So the execution time has changed by minus 30%. That means it is reduced by 30%. What is the increase in performance? So new performance, and performance is the inverse of execution time. So new performance is 1 by 70, minus old performance, which is 1 by 100, divided by old performance. So this gives me, you know, 100 by 70 minus 1, which is 42%. Okay, so this is how you compute the different terms. So just do understand the difference between speedup and percentages. So this concludes my discussion of, you know, performance measures and different metrics. And in the next series of lectures, we'll start looking at pipelining.